There is no one better than him to tell us how learning from nature is our best bet for creating a better and more sustainable world. Please welcome him to the stage. Thank you. Good luck. Thank you.
Buongiorno.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone, ladies and gentlemen. And this is a forum on food and nutrition. And therefore, one has to start from what makes possible to be fed. We have to start from the plants. And let's start from this picture. This is a 50-year-old picture, was taken on December 24th, 1968. And this is a picture that has a feature. This is the first color picture of our planet seen from outside. This is our planet. This is the first time that was being photographed, and then this picture has been followed by many others. We have them on our mobile phones or desktop of our computers. The feature is the three colors, blue, white, and green. Green is the color of vegetation. Blue means water, and white means clouds. But what's important and what's fundamental here is to understand that these three colors all depend on trees, on plants. Plants cause, through photosynthesis, the very life of this planet. But without plants, we'll have no water or clouds. And the temperature of this planet will become so high to make impossible the very presence of water. And the Earth would become like Mars. Therefore, plants are essentially the element that makes our life possible on this planet. And how many of them have we? And this is another piece of information that escapes from most of us all. 85% of biomass of our planet, that is the weight of life, is made by plants, animals, and I'm not talking about humanity or mankind, but all the animals all together, fish, birds, amphibians, reptiles, insects, etc., amount to 0.3% of our biomass. All animals means 0.3%. Plants account for 85%. How is it possible that some living organisms that we perceive as being passive, not able to do anything, were able to reach this incredible success in terms of evolution if compared with ours? Well, one of the things that we normally think about plants is that plants are completely passive. They cannot feel the world around them. They cannot have strategies or process things and actions, in a word, to be intelligent. And this is a completely wrong idea. Look at this little plant, which is just springing up, is Coscota. This plant is a parasite, and this plant needs 3 days to find a host. It's perfectly in a position of perceiving what's around it and getting to the host. The plant perceives whatever surrounds her. This is a parasite, but let's look at another one. Look what happens if we put a Coscota in between two plants, a tomato and a wheat plant. She is choosing. She is choosing the best host and eventually goes towards the tomato plant, because the tomato plant is the easiest host to indeed host a parasite. Or look at this plant. This is a bean plant. All of us know that these plants have to grow on walls, and they are rampicants. And some of you might have doubts in terms of where the support, where the trellis is. The plant knows it very well and goes towards it by making use of whatever is possible, that is resorting to a strategy. This plant is using whatever movement possible to get to the trellis, and a hook has already been created at the very tip of this branch so that the plant can branch out. And after a number of attempts, the plant can first touch this pole, and then eventually, with a last effort, the plant hooks up to the pole. Well, if you watch a video like this, you cannot have any doubt on the fact that plants are not perceiving the environment around them. This plant proves immediately its own ability of perceiving whatever surrounds it. So how do you measure the intelligence? I'm not talking about men and women, but in animals, you measure it through having them go through a maze, measuring the time needed for an animal to get to the way out of a maze. We cannot use the same technique as with the one that we use with the plants, but we can have an option. How many times a plant goes in a wrong direction before getting out from a maze, from a labyrinth? What you see here is the tip of a root. This root has to reach this particular square because you have ammonium nitrate that is the equivalent of cheese for rats. And look what the plant does. The plant never gets in the wrong direction. Whenever there is a bifurcation, the plant always makes the right choice. Look at it. Here we are. Once again, the right choice. And once again, the plant gets here. The plant has solved the problem of a maze without ever making mistakes. Many of you may think, well, this is an easy maze. I imagine that many of you are thinking this is an easy maze, as if normally, you know, you would watch plants getting a way out or solving the problem of a maze. Well, the same type of maze, the same type of labyrinth, when indeed presented to men, causes a 70% error rate, which means that 70 times out of 100, a human being makes a mistake. So there is no difference. Why is it that solving a labyrinth for an animal is a measurement for intelligence and for a plant it isn't? This is another video clip showing you another issue to be solved. How can you actually free yourself from a weight? This is a glass panel with a weight, 2.8 kilos, and below you have small plants. This is not an easy problem to solve. Also for animals, this is a very complex thing, because this problem, in order to be solved, requires a displacement of the center of the weight. You will see the way plants solve it. Look what happens. The first thing that happens here, and this is fundamental, is just moving their center of gravity. And once you move your center of gravity, the plants swap the weight, and you see they move the weight. They worked all together, and this is the only way to solve such a problem. And this is another extraordinary feature by plants, the fact that plants indeed have a kind of team intelligence, if you like. I don't know whether I convinced you in 5 minutes only about the fact that plants are intelligent beings, but my next 4 or 5 minutes I'm going to use to try to convince you to think that we are not the most intelligent beings on this planet, because I'm sure many of you in this room are thinking, well, we men and women are definitely better, behave definitely better than a cow, than an apricot tree, or a felt. Because we can devise the theory of relativity to write the Karamazov's Brothers or paint the Sistine Chapel. No one else would ever be able to do anything like it. And here we are wrong, because this doesn't mean anything. You know, this has nothing whatsoever to do with the idea of being better or behaving better than another being. What does being better mean? Better is one of the most dangerous ideas or concept ever imagined by man within the evolution. Feeling that you're better than other living beings or men and women means using them. Feeling better than, or feeling that you're better than other beings means really making full use of them, exploiting them. But apart from an ethical issue, are we really better than others? To say so, you require a result and you require to measure efficacy. Example, if you are in a competition of jumping, if you jump for 2 meters, you're said to be better than someone who just jumped 1.5 meters. But in life, what is the final target? That's what is missing. The target of life is very simple, is the propagation of our own species. The fact that we have painted the Sistine Chapel and or written the Karamazov's Brothers, if this does not help our species to propagate, this is not an advantage. Propagation of the species is the first point. And so let's ask ourselves, what about the average life of a species on a planet? I'm telling you, 5 million years, a species lives on this planet on average 5 million years. And we, what about us? We are here since the last 300,000 years. So we're not even the average. If our brain were not either an advantage or a disadvantage, but we would just be in the average, this means that we have another 4.5 million years ahead. I don't think that many of you in this room think that we as a species may survive such a long time. If we think that whatever we have done, for good or for evil, we did it over the past 15,000 years only. Think about a perspective of 100,000, 200,000, 1 million years. If we were there at that time, we would have proven to be incredibly less efficient vis-a-vis other species surviving 5 million years. This is a pivotal point. This is a fundamental point. Why do I say so? Because it's our extraordinary boldness as a species. We are a species which called itself sapiens sapiens twice to have brought us in the situation we are into right now. And we have immediately to try to carry out a kind of Copernican revolution, like Copernicus and Galileo's took the Earth from the center of the universe and set it where it should be. We have to urgently do exactly the same thing in terms of man's perception. Man's, or mankind, is not the center of life. It's just one of the hundreds of thousands of species populating this planet Earth, all needed to preserve life. This is a network that has to be preserved as is. And plants can teach us a lot about it. Plants can teach us how to survive because they did it, because they've proven how the way they can survive, and they've solved most of the problems that we are confronted with. Look at them, and we will have a very long and important future. Thank you very much indeed.